Dr. Howard Stenzer, except till maybe when we get to Vic.
Don't hold your breath.
Howard is a professor emeritus here from this department, he's a geologist, but he came here in 1970 and taught until 2004, so that's some amount of years. And but up until leading to that, he got his bachelor's degree in the University of Minnesota. Is there any Minnesotans around?
Oh, you betcha.
Yeah, you betcha. And then the University of Wyoming after that for his master's, and then his PhD at the University of Washington. So he stuck to the big universities, big R1 universities, and then he came to Chico and was here for 34 years.
Yeah.
Wow. 34 years, yes. Yes. So we're very fortunate to have. He's been very fortunate to have him here. He's been through an entire court case, which he'll discuss. But leading up to this talk, I asked Howard, "Is it okay if I showed a Hollywood trailer, a Hollywood video, a preview for a movie that has some relation to what he's going to talk about today?" And if we can get the lights, we'll start with that trailer, and then I'll hand it over to Howard. Let's see if we can do this.
So if you'll take a second, look at the plan.
Will you hear it?
You'll see what I see. And that's money.
Not our money.
Oh, mama, I'm in fear for my life from the long
arm.
Baby, where are you going?
This gold is this a wheel of years ago. But it's amazing how little gold does. You can just change everything.
Damn it, Kenny.
Long live is winning.
That's where we'll find the gold.
Wait!
We found nothing and the workers are leaving.
Wait.
Kenny, look. We got a gold mine.
We got a gold mine!
For better or worse, the ride has begun. And what a ride.
For a second.
This is Ryan Wolf in New York.
They were coming at a small size.
We believe you're sitting on the largest gold find of the decade.
We're talking over $30 billion.
Washoe Maya turned into a rocket ship.
Who else could have deal?
Who could have deal with him?
This isn't a deal.
No boss. No deal.
Open it.
We're very powerful people, very angry.
Our military is taking over the mine.
These people are using you.
They need to steal it away.
It is the FBI!
The gold mine. I found it.
And the only question I'm left with is, how did $17 billion disappear overnight?
Titled Gold, came out a couple years ago, and I know Russell has seen it, and I've seen it. Somebody else must have seen it. Not a great movie. However, what the movie portrayed, it was inspired by real events. True enough, the full story is shown. That's the cover of this book. It's called the Briex Scandal. And people don't think about mining swindles. in modern times. But that was 20 years ago. That's all. 20 years ago was the greatest mining swindle in the history of mining. Now, they exaggerated it in the movie. They said $17 billion. It wasn't that big. $6 billion. That's pretty big. That's pretty darn big. Okay, so $6 billion, and I'll point out a couple of other things. The role that Matthew McConaughey played in the movie was a combination of two people in the movie. He was a geologist in the movie, but there was another guy who was more or less the promoter. And the promoter wasn't a geologist. He was the enthusiastic salesman who was probably an innocent party. The geologist, Matthew McConaughey, was not an innocent party. He had a pretty legitimate career for 20 years or so before that. And then he went to the dark side. And when it was all done, he's down in the Cayman Islands with a lot of money. And his partner, who was a Philippine geologist by the name of Michael de Guzman, and the real story of Michael de Guzman was that as the scandal was exploding, being exposed, he reportedly committed suicide by jumping out of a helicopter into the jungle of Borneo, where the mine supposedly was to be. They found a body, not likely his, but somebody was found. Magically, you find a body 4 days after it fell out of it or jumped out of the plane or was thrown out of the helicopter, I should say, badly chewed up and unrecognizable in the jungle. What are the odds of finding, you lose helicopters in the jungle for a year. How do you find a body in 4 days? Strange credibility. And something that has not been in the news that my research has unearthed is that one of Michael de Guzman's wives, he had four that he was, they all thought they were the wife, but he had four of them, among other women in his life. But one of his wives received an unsolicited check from Brazil a few years ago to the tune of $25,000. And she thought she recognized his handwriting in the return shipping thing, but again, not verifiable. So that was a very sinister thing that managed to escape with $6 billion, a lot of money lost. And that's the ultimate swindle. The one I'm gonna talk about isn't quite so big. It's still pretty darn big. And I might say that while I was a faculty member here at Chico, back in the heyday of increased interest in gold, which came about with the rise of gold price. You may remember, or many of you are too young to remember, but there was a time when the price of gold was fixed at $35 an ounce. Not much interest in looking for gold at that price. But then in 1971 or two, the lid was taken off and the price of gold could reach wherever it was, the demand would carry it. So during the 1970s, it climbed. And I have a graph that, we'll come back to that. Where's the graph? Well, there was a graph that shows the price of gold. Let's just, maybe we'll run into the graph. In any case, the price of gold, the initial spike was about 1980. And that brought gold up to about $800 an ounce, a troy ounce. Now, a troy ounce is not the same as your household cooking ounce. There are 12 troy ounces in a troy pound, but that's not the same as a 16-ounce pound either. But there's 31.1 grams in a troy ounce. That's the unit of measure for precious metals, at least gold and silver and platinum. But the price spiked, and at that time, out of the woodwork came all kinds of legitimate and illegitimate gold mining schemes. I had a lot of them walk through my office door, people who were interested in investing. And as a public servant, and I was the one who taught economic geology, so I was always the one that they referred me to. So come to my office and they say, well, I'm wanting to invest in this. What do you think? Or words to that effect. And I would usually donate, you know, half an hour of my time to probe what they know and what they should do, or and never tell them what to do. They have to decide what they're going to do. But I intercepted a few very, very bad decisions in time, and some it was like, I wish you had come to me sooner. This is after they had already invested $40,000 or so. And these weren't necessarily stupid people. They were just ill-informed, and they got caught up in gold fever. Gold fever is very contagious. Mercifully, I was spared that. I'm immune. I was never one to be caught with gold fever, but I met plenty of people who were. So, over that period of time, I had quite a few drop-ins, people wanting to talk about it, and some of them involved properties that were very close to Chico, not very far. The headwaters of Little Chico Creek up by Magalia, places like that, or out on Dry Creek near Butte College. You wouldn't imagine there's something that close. They're there, or they were there. And then some that someone would say, well, I've got this thing and I'm really interested. And then they dropped the hint, well, they'd like me to go out and look at it. Well, the trouble is, the looking at it involved me traveling for a day or two. And I said, you want me to go out of town on my weekend, et cetera, you're gonna have to pay me. So I wasn't free at that point. I'm free for a 30-minute drop-in, but not for a day or two in the field to look at something. And so I intercepted one where the guy actually flew me down to San Diego, and I met somebody who was probably the smarmiest fraudster I've ever met, personally. I mean, this guy with a straight face, and this may not mean much to everybody here, but some of you will. He had buckets of dirt that came from the Mojave Desert, just from the surface. And these buckets of dirt supposedly were placer gold deposits. And this is where he started astray right off the bat. The assays ran, you know, $60, $80, $100, you know, or $60, $80, 100 ounces per ton, which is absurd. Why do you need anybody else's money if you have that kind of value? It's crazy. But these people didn't know better. So I had to inform them that you don't want to spend your money on this because it's a fraud, it's a sham. So later, after the early peak of $800, it tapered down to around $400, where it sat around $400 for quite a while. And then it started to climb. And then it reached its second peak in 2013, with the peak up around $1,800. So there was a lot of interest in gold, but a lot of legitimate gold mining interest. So the gold mining industry of California literally exploded after the prices went up. So now we have major gold deposits across northern Nevada and elsewhere, where there are large-scale operations. Many of you have heard of Barrick industry. Barrick didn't exist prior to 1983, and I might point out that a Chico State student cited the discovery drill hole that started Barrick, so we're pretty proud of that, Eric Lau. And it's now a mega billion dollar company with a major deposit, or more than one, in Northern California, or Northern Nevada, excuse me. So this all leads up to a phone call that I received. And the phone call, I was just in my office, and I answered the phone, and the guy said, well, my name is Robert Rubin, I'm an attorney for the Internal Revenue Service in Milwaukee. We are looking for a person knowledgeable with credentials who is knowledgeable about placer gold deposits and placer gold mining. Your name has been suggested. So I didn't seek anything out, they found me. And to this day, I don't know who it was that told them about me, but somebody obviously knew that I had worked on various smaller placer deposits in Northern California, and that's where they all were. He said, we're looking for an expert, or someone to be an expert. And So he said, I said, well, I paused and I said, convince me I'm working for the good guys. Okay. And he said, well, I'll send you a bundle of things. So he sent me a courier pouch that was sent to my house. Opened it up and I started to read and I thought, wow, what a deal. There was a prospectus for something that's called Gold for Tax Dollars. Okay. Very enticing, about 100 pages thick, with about a dozen or 10 or 12 pages of legal boilerplate that was just by some Wilshire Boulevard law firm that put all this stuff together and basically said, you, a wealthy man, exclusively for wealthy people, wealth was defined by this prospectus as being pretty much you have to have a lot of liquid assets and a lot of your money has to be in the highest tax bracket. Now at the time, the late 70s, the tax bracket, who has any idea how high the tax bracket was, the highest tax bracket? It was at the highest it was 70%, but by 1980 it was dropped to 50%. But in order to get into that category, you had to have more than $400,000 of income to start. And that was a fair piece of change back in 1980. They didn't settle for that. So, all this money, and a prospectus came out, and the prospectus was created by a man by the name of Gerald Rogers. He was the con man. Okay, you have to have somebody pretty much unprincipled who comes up with the idea. Now he was a smart man who could have probably made a lot of money by being honest, but he chose the dark side to live in, and it worked well for him. So I looked at this bundle of things that were sent to me and prowled through it and I realized, these people, these fat cats, were basically not paying taxes. They were escaping paying taxes by a creative scheme that said, in a simple way, invest $10,000 in this Placer property, and you can deduct four times that much from your tax obligation. Think about it. Now there's a deal. There's a deal. You send $10,000 to Panama City, Panama, I might add, and then you will magically be sent a piece of paper that says you have made this investment and you are entitled to this deduction. There were over 3,100 people who invested in this with a typical investment of at least $10,000, and some invested a lot more. Okay, so if you do the numbers, you realize that's a lot of money. It's a lot of money. So let's take a closer look at some of these things. This map is basically to show how much running around I had to do, or at least think about having to do. This is Chico. And the properties, one was in Panama in 1978, and the other one was in French Guiana in 1979 and 1980. Now the reason that it moved from Panama to French Guiana was pretty simple. Even the con man realized that they didn't have a legitimate property in Panama. In order for this to have any credibility, there had to be proof in the ground that there is a viable mineral deposit, that a prudent man could reasonably explain away their investing in this property. And one of my tasks was to point out or figure out that that wasn't the case. All of the data said, no, you don't want to spend your money there. So even they figured it out. So they teamed up with a mining geologist. We'll talk a little bit more about him in a bit. That's some interesting characters, and he was one of them. And this guy had said, well, there's this property that has been a placer gold property for a long time in French Guiana. Now, if you're interested in finding that, if you have Google Earth on your iPhone or your computer, just look at French Guiana, and you will find this barren piece of ground in a certain part of French Guiana. That's the property, because otherwise you're looking at tropical rainforest. It's all green vegetation and very little else, because French Guiana, a small country, a couple hundred thousand people, the size of the state of Indiana, and most of the people live on the coast. So what's inland are a few drainage ways, and there are placer gold properties, but they've been operating these things for 100 years on a small scale. So if you go back to that, go ahead to the property. Before I do that, let's jump back. When this thing blew up and finally ended up in court, the first trial I was involved in was in Tampa, Florida. That was the big trial. There was a follow-up trial that involved one case. Somebody petitioned the court. My situation was different than everybody else. So you had 3,100 people who were encompassed in one thing, and one guy said, no, my case was different, and I ended up having to work in his case, and that one was in Cleveland, Ohio. 6 years later, I might add. And finally, the con man behind it all, when he was eventually indicted and caught, his trial was in Denver. So it was Denver federal court, and these were in tax courts. Tax courts are different from the other courts. But so I saw a few courtrooms, lots of attorneys, and lots of interesting characters. So, let's hear. Now, typical mining swindle, usually they involve gold, because gold, it mesmerizes so many people. Sometimes it'll work with gold, with silver, and platinum's a harder sell, but it is equally mesmerizing, and then rarely try it with diamonds. But assuming it's gold, which this one was, the common methods of a swindle is to salt, meaning you put something that wasn't there naturally, and salting. You mess up the assays that are run, and then sometimes you can con people by, you have some negative information, but don't tell them that. Feed them the good stuff, and then leave out the bad stuff. What crime have you committed? Sin of omission, as you would say. And then occasionally there are land title gimmicks. But these are the common methods for ordinary mining swindles, like the Briex thing, which was the largest in history. And of course, ultimately behind it all is a lot of greed involved. Now these are actual photographs of the property in French Guiana. And what you are seeing, we'll just focus on, this is just a drag line that's dragging material out of the gravels out of this pond. This is what we would call the washing plant. And the drag line drags stuff up, feeds it into a hopper, runs through this processing plant to separate the gold. And over here, they didn't explain this, but they're using mercury, among other things, very bad. But you can do that in French Guiana. You can probably do anything in French Guiana. And they actually were processing gold. So there was a gold property there. There was gold there. It met that necessary criterion. However, it didn't meet some of the other criteria. Now my job, among other things, and this points out more carefully where these places are located. The one in southern Panama was very close to the Colombian border. One in French Guiana was just out in the jungle. As you might expect, the question was raised by my attorney, actually raised by me before my attorney brought it up, but it was like, do you need to go down there? And my answer was, not unless absolutely necessary, because a friend of mine who has been down there, I called him. It's good to have connections. Called him and said, there's this property down in French Guiana that I may have to go look at. His comment to me was, understand that if you go there, you're going to come back with something you wish you hadn't. Okay? So you're going into the tropical rainforest, and you're going to come back with parasites and malaria and who knows what else. Well, I didn't want to go, as you might expect, but I didn't have to. And for the simple reason that, this is a picture showing what the landscape would have looked up a little up closer. This happened to be in a part in southern Panama, where there wasn't a viable operation. And it was, by all descriptions, it was horrible. The Darien province, if you look at Google Earth at southern Panama and you walk, you see the Pan American Highway and it stops. It does not carry on through. It's not finished yet, because they don't want to have to build through that stuff. Very expensive, very difficult to do. Well, that's where the Placer property was, ostensibly. So I opted not to go, but this is the kind of stuff I had to work with. Terrible, terrible maps. I was sent enormous amounts of data by actual measure when they started sending things to me to look at and to read. 6 feet high, 8.5 by 11s. Now, what was my job? Read it, all of it. Know everything that's important that's in there. We don't know what's important. Your job as the expert is to find what's important, pull it out so we can use it. Well, this is some of the stuff. This was, the blue represents drainage ways, little tributaries of the main drainages where the Placer works were located. And it's not terribly good. This is one that's one of those drainages in blue. This simply showed more dramatically the alluvial material. That was what was going to have to be processed. In mine, not very good. However, this is one of those drainages, and this shows the sampling that was done. Now, the sampling that was done, the initial sampling was done by a Belgian contract mining company. It was from Belgium, it was almost half government and half private. Whatever they had.
That says dead cow.
Yeah, dead cow. It was a dead cow drainage, true. But you'll notice they had traverses, and each of these little spots was a hand dug pit. So think about it. There were 1,200 hand dug pits dug to a depth of primarily about 3 meters. So say 10 feet, dug down to bedrock, and then sampled and processed. So they had data from 1,200 pits. Now, what could I do if I went down there for a week that would in any way negate that? I couldn't. I said, there's nothing I could do that would make any sense. Because I knew what their sampling technique was, how they did their business. These people knew what they were doing. And furthermore, there was a separate company that was hired a few years later to go back in to the same property, and they resampled about 200 of these things. They just dug a pit right next to one of these existing pits to verify. And they came back with pretty good comparison numbers. So I figured, okay, my function is to at least acknowledge that this is a well-sampled area. They can make some legitimate decisions about what's what. And this is examples of the data sheets. The results, the original work that was done by the Belgians, the B and the BMG is Belgian. And these are in grams per per cubic meter. That's in the US, of course, we use English units, so it's cubic yards. This is French, it's in cubic meters. And then this was the other company that came in a few years later, the verification pits, and they were very similar. So I was confident that they had good data. Okay. So that didn't negate, in other words, it was a legitimate placer gold mining property. Didn't mean the whole thing was legitimate, just meant that part was legitimate. So here's how the gold for tax dollars scheme worked. Gerald Rogers, he was the con man. And if you took a typical investor who had $10,000 to invest, for that he was able to secure 5,000 cubic meters of gravels for $10,000. Sends it to Panama City. Most of that money, 3/4 of it, went to Gerald Rogers, who had an office in Panama City. About $500 went to the miner operator to give him supplies and pay for equipment on the property in French Guiana that we saw in the pictures. The brokers, these were the people who were brought in to market the deal, the brokers. They got 20%, heck of a deal. To entice brokers in for $2,000 on a $10,000 investment. And then the investors, by doing this, saved at least $20,000. So what did they do? They sent a check here, and they got a check there, or de facto a check. Who loses? Well, the federal tax treasury does, or the treasury does. In other words, the people who pay their taxes legitimately, we're the ones that get the shaft, and they're the ones that escape. So that was what was deemed an abusive tax shelter. And the truth of the matter is that almost nobody who invested in this cared if there was any gold there or not. They had no intention of ever seeing their property mined or anything else. They didn't care. This is what they cared about. Okay? But they're all now, and once the IRS said, you know, you can't do that. You're allowed to deduct what you actually spent, but you can't deduct four times as much. So the IRS was the defendant in this case. Okay. Now, one of the reasons that they came to me was they told me there had been, prior to this case, the IRS case, there had been a case before the SEC. There was a case, that's the Security Exchange Commission. And the SEC lost, and the IRS attorney said, they lost, we do not plan to lose. Therefore, we have to have an expert that has credentials equal to the SEC experts, because the SEC had experts, or the other side had experts with PhDs and experience. SEC went to trial with their in-house geologists who didn't really have any placer experience and had a bachelor's degree in geology. And he said, they got beat. So he said, we don't plan to lose. So they're like, oh, thank you. Put the, and then he said, I asked him, who are the names of these two consultants that they had, these experts? I knew both of them. So it was like, and he said, you have to be prepared to meet them in court, at least courtroom duel, if you will. I've seen enough movies to know that could be interesting. But I was confident that they wouldn't show up. I was pretty sure that given the circumstances that I was aware of, there's not a chance in the world, I thought, that these guys would touch it. And that proved to be the case. So they did not show up. And so I was pretty much unopposed. Now the players involved, Gerald Rogers, he was the con man. He invented this thing. He located this guy named Wayne Fowler, who is a mining geologist, his home base was Albany, Georgia. Looks like Albany to most of us, but the locals, it's Albany. News to me. He was the contract miner, experienced, but interesting. PhD geologist, University of Indiana. For those of you old enough to remember Wild Kingdom on TV, there was a big husky guy about 6'4 named Jim Fowler who'd always wrestle anacondas and stuff like that. This is his brother, Wayne Fowler. And Wayne Fowler, interesting, a little sideline that he had, in Albany, Georgia, he had an exotic animal farm. How do you suppose that came about? Well, he had connections in Latin America to get these animals out of Latin America. into Georgia. Where he had an exotic animal farm. Wayne Fowler, I believe, was, call him a dupe, in that he thought he was engaged in a legitimate activity. Because there was gold there, he could process it, he had the equipment and the personnel to make it work. He didn't know how the scheme was going to be judged. But I met him in the court, outside the courtroom, and his lament was, he rued the day that he ever met this guy, because he says, I've been doing nothing but getting involved in lawsuits, going to court. I'm sure he's very expensive. Lawyers are expensive. And so that was the gist of it. Now, the characters, other characters, Tyler Kittredge, he was a Panamanian geologist, American born, but he lived in Panama City. And Wayne, Gerald Rogers, my vision of how they met, they probably met in a bar in Panama City. And Gerald Rogers was looking for a way to set up his scheme, the goal for tax dollars. Tyler Kittredge was a promoter. And you saw the video, the movie clip. The guy was a promoter. Just exciting. He had a concession, legal access from the Panamanian government to see if they could develop a mineral deposit in the Darien province of southern Panama. So he was forever trying to convince people to come in here. And the thing is, he didn't have the money to do it, so he was looking for other people's money to come in and develop this property. And so he kept producing these reports. Every year he'd have an annual report, and each report looked better than the previous year, but nothing had happened other than embellishment. And then finally, when Gerald Rogers realized, man, this isn't going to work, so then he had Wayne Fowler, the Georgian, said, okay, we need to move, and let's go to French Guiana. Now this other character, Cy Uter, he was the only person out of 3,100 plus who actually was interested in having his property mined. He wanted to go down there and he wanted to watch it being mined. He truly had gold fever. He wanted to see those little ingots of gold. So he looked at the maps that showed the sampling sites, and he found the ones that were the biggest, the highest grade. He says, that's the parcel that I want. So they said, fine, we'll mine that parcel. So he went down there and he watched for 30 days. He watched them work the property and he saw them produce the gold, and they melted it down into these little gold bars. And then he was politely informed by the French Guiana government, oh, by the way, you do understand that you can't remove any gold from French Guiana. Not legal. He wasn't happy. So he turned around and sued in Panamanian court for fraud, and he won. Of course, how do you collect anything? Because it was down in French Guiana, or I said Panama, French Guiana. So that was interesting. But the part that made it a couple more interesting characters, John Kitchen is local. He lived in Chico until he now lives in Corning, I believe, but he's close. But he grew up in Placer Gold Country in Jute Creek Canyon. And in the area. So he was familiar from his childhood with gold mining ventures. He was invited down to French Guiana to be a broker. He invited down a chartered plane that flew a bunch of brokers down. And I didn't know this. In fact, John used to hang around the campus over in the coffee shop just to talk to faculty and tell them about the latest hot deal that he was selling. And he mentioned to me, it was one day that he'd been down to French Guiana and looked at this gold mining property. Well, that occurred before I was contacted by the IRS. So I didn't think anything about it until I got the call from IRS and I said, French Guiana, John Kitchen, French Guiana. I bet he was down there. So I called him up and I said, John, we need to go to lunch. I took him to lunch in Chico. And at lunch, he says, what's this about? And I said, well, I've just been retained by the IRS to work as an expert in this trial. involving a tax shelter down in French Guiana. He says, I think you were there. And as I describe this, you can see the blood drain out of his head, just literally. And he basically said, he sort of paused and he said, I said, I'm sure you took pictures. I'd like to see those pictures. He said, on one condition, he said, you have to promise that my name will never be mentioned. Keep me out of it. And I said, why is that? He says, because the people that I met were the kind of people that put others in pine boxes. He was convinced of that. True or not, he was convinced. So he did not buy in as a broker. He stayed out of it, but he was genuinely frightened by the whole process. So these were not good people. Now the really bad person here, this one is great, Trenton Parker in Denver. He was a con man who cheated the con man. Now that takes a special gift. What Trenton Parker did was to clone the actual prospectus, gold for tax dollars. He literally had it reproduced and sent it out, but with a different return address that went to an office in Denver, which was his office. So the people who were investing in French Guiana who had no intentions of going down there sent the money to this guy's office. Okay? So, except that Gerald Rogers found out about it. So Gerald Rogers, and he was with, Wayne Fowler was with him. Somebody said, you know, there's this guy in Denver who's peddling a deal, looks awful lot like yours. They go into his office. Well, I learned that Gerald Rogers has a very short fuse. He went in and literally attacked this guy. And then he quickly went into his back room and came out with a gun and called the police. And they had had Gerald Rogers and Wayne Fowler arrested. So they were taken off by the police, and this guy, smiling all the way to the bank for a while, but eventually they caught up with him. And the part that jolted me was when I read that they were investigating him and for fraud, and they subpoenaed his secretary, and she was the one who would receive the mail with the checks. And she was to give a deposition one day, and the day before the deposition, she reportedly jumped out of the 10th floor story window of the office building. Or, perhaps more likely, she got tossed out because she was the one who could say what went on in the office. Don't know. But that was something that I just discovered in the reading that I did. Pretty amazing. So, okay, so the expert, that's back to me, in this case. You have to have credentials, and in my case, we figured you better have advanced degrees, PhDs, experience. Experiences, if you go in there without experience, you're dead, because they're gonna have somebody who's got a lot of experience. And who are you gonna believe? Anybody who's been in a jury where there are expert witnesses, you pay attention to what are the credentials. What is their experience? Because that's important. And you have to be confident. There's not a place for somebody, yeah, I don't know about this. You can't be wishy-washy. And you have to be able to write well and compile, synthesize. So remember my 6-foot-high stack of stuff. I had to wade through all of that over a span of 2 years in my spare time. So I was sitting there with a highlighter and post-it flags. When I'd find something of interest, I had to mark it so I could find it again. Because my attorney, who subsequently got transferred from Milwaukee to Sacramento, fortunately, so we could get together, he would come up to Chico or I would go down to Sacramento. And he said, your job is to write a report. So, first of all, I had to read everything. Now I have to write a report. And here's the part that kind of surprised me, because you know, students and ex-students, you've all written reports and stuff. You usually have an idea as to how long and what it's supposed to involve. So this lawyer is telling me, you are to write a report, okay? And I said, is there any format to the report? No, he says, you select the format that's best, okay? And I, yeah, how long? He says, as long as it has to be. Okay, that's helpful. So are you going to want to look at a draft or get going on this? Absolutely not. He says, I am never to even hear about a draft again. The only thing I want to see is the finished product. And no drafts ever existed other than the finished product. This is where I was learning about how the legal process works. Because if you have a draft, that can become a piece of data that they can come after in discovery. The other side, if they so choose, you know, I don't have any drafts, all I did was this one final copy. And it has to be submitted to them 15 days ahead of trial. Exactly 15 days. So I had a trial date 15 days before that, and he said, no later, no sooner. We want that report. And the report is to cover all of the aspects that are pertinent to the case, which I've been informed of. And he says, and your job is to educate the judge. This was a trial before a judge, not a jury. And he said, you're the educator. You're the professor. You're supposed to be able to explain things in ways that people who don't understand stuff understand it. Okay, that's my job. And then, once in the courtroom, you have to listen to the testimony that's going on by other parties, and then you have to be prepared to advise the attorneys as needed. And then you hope that you don't miss something. So that's what I had. Now, the key things that I had to do, the decisions, the geologic decisions or the mining-related decisions were not that difficult. But here's the part that made it comical. They were selling quantities of gravels. For $10,000, you get 5,000 cubic meters of gold-bearing gravel from a parcel. Well, first of all, no parcels existed. So, based on what? Well, they hastily, when they realized that they better get some parcels, so they went out and just measured out about 100. But they sold, based on the quantity of reserves that were calculated. I had to calculate reserves by assuming a thickness, not very complicated. All those drill holes, the area of influence of a drill hole, or a pit, as it were, and its thickness, you can calculate volumes. And then you just go through and say, okay, we've got, you know, so many million cubic meters. Except that when they put the deal together, they sold over four times as many parcels, if you will, quantities, than was demonstrably in existence. So it's like, okay, we're gonna sell you the Brooklyn Bridge in pieces, but we're going to sell you 4,000 more pieces, or four times as many pieces as exists with Brooklyn Bridge. But who cared? Nobody cared, because they got their money. But the U.S. Treasury didn't get their money. So when it was all done, Mr. Gerald Rogers, they pursued Gerald Rogers for fraud, and he was subpoenaed to appear in federal criminal court with 13 charges of racketeering. But he skipped the country. So I get this notice that I was to testify at his criminal trial. But then I got a second message that said, forget it, we will contact you again after we locate this man and get him back into the States. So 4 years later, they were able to find him in Switzerland, where he was setting up some other kind of a scam, and he got caught, and the Swiss didn't want him, so they were willing to ship him back. So Gerald Rogers did get his day in court, criminal court in this case, and he was found guilty of 13 counts of racketeering and was sentenced to quite a substantial number of years of free room and board in a federal penitentiary. And but one follow-up tidbit came out of this. Some years later, there was an article in the Denver Post questioning where the son of Gerald Rogers could have possibly come up with $14 million so that he could purchase the, some pass. There was a ski and tennis resort in a mountain pass in Colorado that was sold. And $14 million from Gerald Rogers' son. So where did he get $14 million from? Well, they were confident that he got it from his father, who had gotten it illegally. But I never heard the outcome of that because it was in a Denver paper. But it was an amazing experience for me to learn all the ins and outs of the legal aspect and also doing some basic applied economic geology to calculate reserves and making estimates of what would be credible. And one other thing, and that is, it's really important. In the courtroom, the expert is the only person entitled to an opinion. Remember that. First thing the lawyer told me, he says, you're the only one in the courtroom who has an opinion that can offer it. And you all see that when people hear, when they want yes or no answers to things or facts. Me, the expert, or any expert can have an opinion. And when you respond, you oftentimes will say, in my opinion, and that is. And of course, you're putting your reputation on the line if you try to deviate from what would be the norm. And that was why I was confident that these two other geologists that I knew, who both worked for a lot of experience with a mining company, they weren't going to be there because their opinion had to have come out the same as mine, looking at the same data. So he wasn't there. So that's my story. Question.
Actually, two questions might be the same. First question is, did the government ever get any of that money back from Gerald or from this scam at all?
They got it back from the investors. In other words, the investors who expected that they were going to get all these tax savings, they were basically had to pay interest and penalties for failure to pay the taxes, but you know, they worked overtime to try to avoid.
I did the numbers, and essentially these people bought two Olympic swimming pools worth of gravels, 5,000 cubic meters.
Right.
According to the mining data, according to the best that they possibly could have gotten, according to the drilling logs, what payout could they have expected if they'd actually done the mining, out of curiosity?
Well, yeah, and of course that was another thing I really didn't get into, which was basically the mining operation. The only way it could have worked, they start at one end of the alluvial thing and they work their way through it. And yet these people were told that you can go and mine your property whenever you want to. So you can mine this parcel, and then somebody can mine that parcel. No, you can't. Not when you're plowing through the jungle with this floating washing plant, which is what you had.
Yeah.
It was called, those things are called doodle bugs, by the way.
They're using drag lines and
using a drag line and this floating thing on pontoons. Yeah.
They weren't doing the classic hydraulic mining.
No, it wasn't blast, because they really weren't big walls of stuff. It's only a few meters thick,
right.
And that was it. But. Also, how many of you are aware of the fact that there was a large operating old-style bucket ladder dredge in this region not too long ago? One person. how many are familiar with the Yuba dredge fields? Okay. Well, there was a dredge that was sitting there since like 1925, which was renovated by a mining company back in the late 70s. They spent $10 million renovating this dredge so that it could dredge to a depth of, at a peak, 140 feet deep. So these dredges float in this deep pond, and it's like think of it as a giant bicycle chain with cups on it, except they're big cups. And then they have a big stacker that pushes it out the other end. And they were working the deeper gravels that hadn't been mined in the early days. And that worked, it was operating. Once it was up and running, it operated with a few mishaps through much of the 80s and early 90s. And then economics caught up with them. And then it sat out there in the pond until, I believe it was 2002, but I'm not sure of the exact year. One day they went out to the pond and somebody had stolen the dredge. It sunk and just gone. And so here was this $10 million dredge, the bottom of the dredge pond, and that's where it is. And why that happened, I have my suspicions. Maybe there was an insurance thing, I don't know.
When you talked about your first gold rush in the 1980s, mm-hmm. That was $400 troy ounce.
Right.
In today's dollars, that's 1280. We're currently looking at about 1270.
Yeah.
Troy ounce, and
right.
Is what we're looking at.
Yeah.
Do you think that we're currently experiencing another gold rush? Is this, or is it just scarcity has gotten to the point where we can?
Well, of course, placer gold like that is pretty much not doable in the States. Well, they still do some of it up in Alaska. And I don't know what Alaska does to get by some of the environmental laws, but and there's always a few small operators.
Yeah,
but who knows? But the other stuff, the gold, the big companies that are operating, they're working at very low grade ores for the most part. And the only way you know it's higher grade is if they're going underground, because underground mining is a lot more expensive. But these big, how many have been to any of the Nevada gold mines? Anybody? Yeah, a bunch of you. You've seen those pits. You've seen those big trucks. I mean, that's pretty impressive.
You know. 120 ton.
Oh, that's a little one.
The loads for the truck.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. The trucks, when they have, the wheels are 13 feet in diameter.
Yeah.
I was just gonna say, to answer your questions, it's basically market demand.
Yeah.
That's what's keeping
the price
of gold. Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Commodity, if you will.
Yeah.
And it's one of the
right.
Primo
yeah.
Very
yeah.
Rivers.
But during
people
the
feel it's stable, because gold's not stable.
Well, but no, it's a good commodity also.
Yeah, it's
it is stable in that sense.
Yeah, but the thing is, the big companies. I mean, they've got so much tied up. I mean, the capital outlay in these things. We're talking $1 billion+ on these things. So, for them to shut down. That's not going to be a simple decision. They may cut back and try to figure out how ways to way to high grade it, but shut it down. They've got an awful lot of money tied up.
A lot of the gold's a byproduct of another product.
In like some other deposits,
yeah, like copper mines.
The copper mines.
All of this stuff.
Yeah, there was a time when the Bingham copper pit in Utah was the second largest gold producer in the country.
Yeah.
Just as a byproduct.
Same with the Anaconda.
Yeah.
One more question.
Since the Guyana government didn't allow the gold to leave, did they keep what they did find at that mine then? Where did that gold actually go?
He probably had to sell it to some local person because he couldn't take it out of the country. I don't know. I didn't see him after that. I just had that one conversation in the hallway outside the court, at the courthouse. But pretty wild.
Let's thank Howard for his wonderful story.